Cornell in the Philippines for 20 years, 1952 to 1972. You have Erie, which started in 1962, and then you have extended UPCA and now UPLB. Now, the point is, they all existed, and nobody could, they all benefit from the benefits of each other. The thing that people in Erie need to remember these days is, without UPLB, there wouldn't be any meaning. Because there's so much connection between the two, and the reason I come over here and talk is because this sort of seminar was given a week, a couple of weeks ago by a friend of mine at Erie, but we can't go back and forth anymore. It's not easy if you're a student. You know, you're a student, and I've done this for an hour. How do I get from here to here? Run down some jeepney that's going to Erie. It's not easy. So the connection between these two is a little bit weak now, and that's probably just not true up here. The entire time that I was in Erie, which was about 12 or 13 years, I taught a course every year at UPLB. I used to talk some courses at Delaware, the School of Economics, and the reason I taught these courses. Because I worked with these two good research assistants for Erie. And one thing I can say about my life is I've always been able to improve people to the standard of me. And that's the secret to success. I came to be something to be here now, and stuff to you. Okay, we're going to go through the group survey, and I'm going to have a couple of take-home messages for you. And I'm going to have some take-home gifts for you later on, so you won't wait at the end. What is the group survey? The group survey started in 1966, and it really started with myself in the engineering department here, going around and thinking about, first of all, what farmers were doing in terms of education. And then I said, well, let's do a whole budget of the cost and returns, wet season, dry season. So we started it in 66, and when I was beginning to do this, I went over to UPCA, Agate Lawn. They had done an excellent survey of the Philippines. But the trouble is, the rats had eaten the data. So there was no data left. So we started from scratch in 1966, and it was a miracle that we considered how many people, how many different teams, directors of economics. Every 4 or 5 years, we repeated the survey with the same group of farmers. Of course, some died, some left, and so forth. But we kept the survey going, and I think we even have the Japanese committed to going the next round. The last one was 2012, so we're due for one in 2016. Now, this group survey goes through the conferences and centers on the Chippewa. And mostly along the main highway, so a little bit of a bias, the fact that it's on the highway, because you have four drainage near the highway, there's certain bias, but on the other hand, it provided us with a lot of information. Now, this is an overview of what I'm going to cover. Yields and variety, machines and so forth, you can read this down. I'm going to go this one step at a time of what's happened over the last 5 decades. Changes in yield and variety. A couple of things to see here is that, I think I can point to you. Okay, look what happened here. somebody, you start off in the 60s, and so the range of years is a bit. 1972, nearly held its first 10 years. And everybody had a party, and we all went to Mount Again, and shook up or something, and melted it. And we congratulated ourselves. And the next thing that happened was it rained for 40 days and 40 nights in Central Luzon. And we lost a third of the wet season crop in Central Luzon that year. And there was not an El Nino and the rest of it. And the problem was that in this period that I'm talking about, there was no rice import from Thailand, and they had no rice. So they had to mix the white corn with the rice in this period here. And Marcos was in trouble because if you have a bad rice crop, you got to do something. You got to do it quickly. So Marcos did two things. First, he declared martial law. And the second thing he did was develop something called Masagana 99. And Masagana 99 was giving farmers credit and fertilizer and everything they needed. And they drove trucks with money to Central Luzon to be sure that they got a good crop. Well, they got a good crop because the weather was better. And maybe they got a good crop because of some Masagana 99. But then everything from Masagana 99 was a joke. And this was adoption of the high yielding variety. IRA, first one, and so forth like that. And so things took off. But quickly, by the 1980s, we were seeing a plateau that we really adopted in this area, the new technology. And we've gone from 2 tons to 4 tons, and in the high season, actually, over to 5 tons. But we more or less have plateaued in this particular period. Now, you can see that toward the end, dry season is picking up. The dry season picks up because of what I call the second phase of the rain revolution, which is groundwater and pumps. And so you can have groundwater pumps in the dry season with high solar energy, and you can get good yield the best season here. Changes in management practices and imports. Okay, now the thing you see here, there are a couple of things I want to show you. First thing is the type of fertilizer. One of the good portions of Gary and elsewhere is that this price of fertilizer, the price of urea dropped dramatically due to a technological innovation in the manufacturing of urea. It had nothing to do with anything else except that they were now able to 300 tons plants produce urea at a much cheaper price. So the price of urea came down, and the number of price of rice went up. And of course, you had this speed not so long ago. You had this period in the year when you had the rice crisis. Over here, in nitrogen, despite the rice crisis, the fertilizer, you can see it's going steadily up and it's being produced about this plateau. So quite a few years, people began to look at the optimum level of nitrogen input. Okay, now this is insecticide use. And this is an interesting story because I still am concerned about the overuse of insecticide. In the early days, garbage and set aside meals. We had a mini kit that had fertilizer set aside and new seeds for the mini kit. And so this affiliation, even here at the research station here, we're dumping insecticides on everything. And you know, if you put insecticides on, the insects from some other fields would come and take your rice away. So everybody was using insecticide. Then beginning in the 1980s, our farmers in Central Zone began cutting back on the use of insecticides. And we were beginning to know what we should have known, and that is overuse of insecticide is like putting oil on fire or gasoline on fire. And gradually, people began to use less and less insecticide. And now the current recommendation is no insecticides for the first 40 days. But in elsewhere in Asia, people are still using too much insecticide. And I think that it involves the people like the National Rice System to take an aggressive stance, not with the farmers, but with the private companies and with the government, and particularly the governments to ban certain insecticides coming into the country. And that's the only way to get at it, is to ban the really important harmful insecticide. And as I say, this problem is elevated from insecticide still exists today, but we realize overuse of insecticide is bad not only for rice crops, but it's harmful for the people, and it's harmful for the animals. And people are still having groundhopper in Thailand and Indonesia in the last couple of years, they have groundhopper attack and so forth. So we're still not there. A lot of these insecticides come from China. China is one of the highest uses of insecticides, and they're dumping cheap insecticides on much of Asia. The herbicide story is simple, that people are using herbicides to reduce the weeding cost. That's the principle.
Farmers aren't making any money. You know, and over
says, no problem. I still think we want to move as well about that. But not making any money and the problems of managing the restrooms and there's too much water and everything. Okay, change in lifestyle with that. So we want to see here the education of the children is increasing in the central zone. And so you can see that some of them even now have college degrees and so forth. And that's changing a lot of the perception. I think even in the U.S. it seems to me that the first thing that a firm family wanted to do, was get out of farming. And I think it's probably true in the Philippines as well. So it poke something out. And this is the income sources, and I'll talk more about that, so I'm trying to see. But the thing you want to see, and I'll point out to you, that's not enough, but remittances. And we're going to talk more about remittances, because that's a very fundamental issue in the Philippines today. So rice farming is a major income source, but rice farming has become a sideline business. Take a look at the house. but I went back, I went back to this for the second time I went back to see Lydia. The sign in the Sorry Sorry store was gone. It blew away. And they said that they went to harvest the rice on a Friday, but on Thursday it rained, and the water came up into the stream, and they lost some of their fish suspension. So that's the risk of growing rice, or even having a house, instead of a certain kind of question. That's not done here, but that can turn to years to be able to discourage. This is Faye, and it's been surveying since 1966. She looks pretty good. She looks a little tired. They have no message. Man is not built by my son. Decided, among other things, the sugar plot, what do they do with their money? Well, they built Ayala Avenue and Fort Spire. And so you've got a little different thing. And the second problem that the Philippines faces in terms of surplus agricultural labor, you've got this labor backed up, is population growth. Even today, the population growth in the Philippines is one of the highest, certainly perhaps the highest in Asia. And it's been that way. It's coming down. It's much lower than it was, but the population growth is another burden on the labor force. So what do you do? Well, this is what the Philippines has done. You want rice and export labor. You see, it makes sense. You see, the situation because there are enough jobs locally, and now you're getting some more growth, but it's not in the service sector, it's not in the industry. So you're exporting your labor, you're importing your rice. And it's not so bad. Yeah, I know that every country and everybody wants to be self-sufficient. But anyway, I think it's going to be quite a while before the government becomes self-sufficient. But that's okay. Now, I've come to about the end of my story. I should say this, that the GDP in agriculture today is 10%. The GDP in remittances is also 10%. So agriculture and remittances, I guess, is the same amount of income for the now, I'm going to take it elsewhere.
Usually, in the funeral part of
Facebook, Instagram, without email.
No questions? No questions?
finally shut up.
You show the different sources of income that at the latter part of your maybe 1990s, the contribution of remittances went up. Remittances.
What?
Remittances. The source of income, the proportion of the income from remittances increased. I think. The remittances, when you said that we export labor, remittances play a very important role in helping invest in agriculture. But they, because the migrants send money to the family left behind to buy inputs. And they help in maintaining the land ownership. Otherwise, they have to dig up.
I think it's an interesting question because the fund size is not changing. And people, actually, most of these people receive, under land reform, receive the rights. So they own the firm. So there's a certain feeling of wanting to maintain that. So I think it may have been a little bit negative in terms of the problem, but there's no question that the farm itself has fairly done. And there's some of the income is helping maintain the farm. And the other thing I think is our survey, I think, a little bit coming to the hill with the farm. For example, that lady I told you, Lydia, her daughter, his little daughter's running. And when I said, you really manage them, not help them, but they need some time. So the whole picture of the farm, now the question really is, what about the rest of the nation? Our farm becomes too small and too hefty. But if you want to be a transition to the larger farm, that's a good question. Yeah.
Sir, can you use the microphone?
These are all friends of mine.
We're the same gray hair. I came to that.
Friends of mine asking questions.
Yes. Randy, you had a very interesting presentation, especially because, you know, it's a three-decade data. And there are so many interesting information to be gathered. One of the data that you presented, which is very interesting, is the declining income from rice. And I have always wondered why economists do not associate the low income of rice to the declining scale of farm rice operation. You know, in the 70s, when we were still doing the HIV, the average rice farm holding was about 3.5 hectares. Today, it has progressively been declining so much so that your average rice farm would be only about 1.5 hectares. When our farmers were 56% in the 70s, there were only 7 million of them. Today, our rice farmers are approximately 30 to 40% of the labor force. But there are 12 million of them. I have always wondered that in our drive for modernization in rice, why we are spending so much on support services and everything else, but we do not look at the profitability of the farmer. And if you are an experienced farmer, one of the biggest factors in the profitability of farming is the size of the farm. There is such thing as economic size farm, and this is very true with rice. That the lower the size of the farm, the profitability is lower. And so if you want rice farming to really be a major industry in the country, if you want people to stick in rice production, you must give them rice farms which are profitable. Not 1.5 hectares, but like in Japan, about 4 to 5 hectares would be what you would call as economic size farm, which is profitable, which will earn income, which is equivalent to the income of a teacher or an engineer in the city. Thank you.
One of the things that you mentioned, Japan, but you have to realize that what typically happens in Taiwan, Japan, so on, is that in the early stages, because agriculture is 50% economy, you tax that. And Taiwan tax that, but they also had a land and tillage program, which benefited the farmers that they owned the land. Then you get to the point where, okay, your industry like Japan has grown. The price in Japan is priced down to the world market. So farmers are well off. Because it's no longer, the company decides, the Japanese economy decides, we're going to now subsidized the farm. Now, U.S. agriculture is exactly the same story. In the early days, agriculture struggled because there was no subsidy. And but at the time that the U.S. economy grew, they could support the agriculture subsidy. And what you're saying, you see, when you say that the labor force in agriculture is twice the GDP in agriculture. You're saying that the labor force in agriculture is not as productive as the labor force in non-agriculture. And that's a nutritional problem. And, I just came from a member of the labor force in agriculture. It's 40% of its employment like that. It's not coming down. So, problem, but I think what we need to understand the fact that you tax at what stage of your development, you tax agriculture because there's nothing else. And then if you have an industry, you subsidize agriculture because you don't have agriculture is a small part of your economy. Anyway, that's the way it is.
We have room for one more question. Don't worry about it. As Dr. Contardo said, we have a very rich source of information here that you presented this afternoon, dating back at 1960s. And since many of us here are students and researchers, I think they would be wondering if they would be able to access the data that you have. Maybe they can use it for their thesis or, you know, further research. Is there a way that, they can access the information that you have?
Access to what?
The data on the website you have, the last page, presentation.
The data, Randy. Can people access the data?
Yes.
Which data?
Okay.
What job is it?
Yes, it's on the web.
Okay.
The data is on the web. And that's the important thing. And in fact, if I can tell you what I'm doing, use the data for the stuff like that. But that's the beauty of my voice. Yeah, I think it's possible to get amazing. So if you look at the website, last slide, it shows you not only the website of the book, but the website of the paper. Yeah, but there it is. Thank you.